Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to welcome you to our panel session on AI and sustainability. I'm Ali Hessami, and I have the pleasure of starting the session and then hand over to Andrea Appel, who is our moderator, to take us through the panel session. But before we jump at the panel discussion on matters of sustainability and AI, I'd like to set the scene that relates to Europe's emission reduction targets approaching fast, and there are great hopes that AI is going to help industry to reach their emission targets. There's another issue at the same time, and that is that we need to ensure AI itself is sustainable, with a particular eye on the significant energy required to train large AI models. On our BDE panel discussion, we will address the complexities of both of these targets, sustainable AI and contribution of AI to sustainability, with the help of views from panelists, and I'll be one of those as well, but present with you from a very wide backgrounds that the panelists come from. Our moderator, Andrea Appel from VDE, will introduce the panelists and guide us through the discussions. Over to you, Andrea.
Thank you very much, Ali. Also, thank you very much for last minute taking over the introduction. As you hear, my voice is not so well. I'm a little bit sick. This is why I cannot be on stage today. And this is why I'm here virtually. So, yeah, we have a great panel discussion today. And I would like to introduce our panelists, because like you already said, they're from very diverse backgrounds. And I think this is going to be very, very interesting for our panel discussion for this very important topic. So I would like to start with you, Anne. Anne is a senior policy and advisor advocacy manager at AlgorithWatch, where she leads the project SUSTAIN, the Sustainability Index for Artificial Intelligence. In addition to her work on the sustainability of AI, she focuses on automation in the public sphere, as well as the use of automated decision-making systems in the working place. She is a researcher at the University of Münster. Welcome, and thank you for being here. Then I would like to introduce Giacomo, head of production marketing and advocacy at Flexidao. He has an academic background in civil and environmental engineering and is at the forefront regarding sustainability initiatives focusing on enabling clean electrification. He also creates engaging narratives which connect energy and sustainability with standards and policy globally. Then, thank you very much for being here. And then next will be Melanie. She is Vice President of Group Corporate Responsibility of Deutsche Telekom. She is responsible for the group-wide design and execution of Deutsche Telekom's corporate responsibility strategy. And this covers a wide range of environmental and social aspects, including sustainable supply chains, finance, and as well as the development of the targets of Deutsche Telekom. Thank you for being here. Then we have Valerie. Valerie is a principal scientist at National Physical Laboratory, which is the UK National Measurement Institute. She leads the European standardization work on green sustainable AI in the CEN JTC 21 Working Group 4, and she has published many, many papers, and is very active as in journals and many conferences, as well as training. And then, last but not least, on stage, live for you, Ali Hessami. He is Director of Research and Development and Innovation at Vega Systems, and he represents UK on CEN-CENELEC IEC Safety Systems, Hardware and Software Standards Committees. In 2017, Ali was appointed to the chair of the technical editor of the new landmark IEEE 7000 standard, focusing on addressing ethical concerns in the system design. And he also is a visiting professor in China and the UK. So, as you heard, we have a very diverse backgrounds here on stage with the people speaking here. And I would like to start with my first question. We're currently in the third wave of the discussions around AI and ethics. And the first one was about the general application fields of AI. The second was practical machine learning and trustworthiness. And the third one now is the sustainability of the development of AI. And this shall ensure that the application is as sustainable as AI itself. So my question would be, and I would like to start with Anne, could you depict what sustainable AI is for you, and when is AI sustainable?
I have two answers for that. The first one is, we have set out a working condition of what AI, sustainable AI is, and that means along the three dimensions, ecological, sustainable, economic, sustainable, and social sustainability, that AI should not endanger social cohesion, it should not reinforce problematic economic dynamics, and of course, it should not risk planetary boundaries. So this is a working condition. It's quite abstract, so it doesn't really help when you go into practice. So what we did is that we identified, based on the literature that is in the field, 13 criteria along these social, ecological, and economic dimensions. And based on these 13 criteria, we then identified more than 40 indicators that kind of lead you to a way of sustainable AI. And of course, in the ecological dimension, it would entail things like the energy resources used by the AI systems, but it also could mean energy efficiency, so kind of valuing the output and the thing that the AI does and the performance with the energy consumption. So it's also relative value here. But we will also include things like data protection, privacy on the social field, non-discrimination and fairness of the automated decision making. And we would also entail openness as part of the economic sustainability, because we see a huge market concentration in AI development. And we see that open data sources, open data sets, and open source AI models could help towards achieving more sustainable AI. And I think what is interesting, I don't want to depict for you a complete picture or a finalized picture of what sustainable AI means. I think we are in the process of defining what sustainable AI can mean, because in this set of indicators that we identified, that you can read up in one of our magazines, we see that there's a lot of conflict between different criteria as well as synergies. So for instance, social dimensions might align quite well with ecological when we talk about data minimalist approaches, for instance. But we also see conflict between non-discrimination and fairness and minimal data sets, for instance. So we are in the process of defining what sustainable AI should mean.
Thank you very much. Now that's already quite a lot, I would say. Melanie, I would like to hand over the question to you, as I know that you already work on this topic for quite some time.
Yeah, thank you. And I think I can very much hook on what Anna already explained very well, is we also do see these three dimensions. And for us at Deutsche Telekom, definitely the starting point on looking at sustainability within and and out of AI was the social ethical dimension, where we started very early with being one of the first providers worldwide to give ourselves ethical development principles, which are implemented not just in terms of a supplier code, but are really implemented into processes, how we scan and audit AI solutions in order to get a positive result. And only then, if it satisfies these criteria sets, it's used within Deutsche Telekom. But as Anna said, that's not everything. It's also the question of whether the development itself is sustainable. And for us, it starts a lot with the question on how is the data center, or how are the data centers on which typically the AI products run, how sustainable are they in terms of the energy consumption, but also in terms of the hardware which is used? Circularity there is a big topic, which also adds to the overall footprint of providing the right infrastructure to run AI. And yes, then it goes into questions like, how can we optimize the processes of developing and training those models and reiterating the processes. And I have to say that area for us is still quite new. It goes very much hand in hand also with discussions around green coding, where standardization is still a big issue. And everyone is looking a little bit into how and where are the best options to implement that. Where we are a little bit further down the road already is that we look at the positive sides of how can AI contribute to providing more sustainable solutions for our customers or clients. So where can we sort of reduce resource consumption by using AI in a good way? What I have to say, what we're still discussing a lot is the one thing is developing AI for industrialized processes, for applications in the B2B world. The second thing is when AI becomes a mass product, like we see at the moment with ChatGPT, for example. Yeah, knowing that OpenAI does a lot on sustainability, tries to, but we also do see that it is not always a targeted use, and each use creates energy demand and resource hunger. And if you just use it to play around, we're easily running into a direction of how do we steer consumption, like with all the other products. And this is also where we're still in discussion, and we don't have an answer on that at all. But I think that's something we need to watch when we talk about sustainable AI. It's also a consumption question. So should we use it for everything where we could use it? Yeah.
Thank you very much for this introduction to your views. Now I have the problem. You mentioned two topics where I could lead to the next panelist, and I would like to give the word to you, Giacomo. What is a sustainable AI for you? What aspects are relevant from your perspective as you work on the monitoring of 24/7 carbon footprint in the energy consumption? So what is important from your perspective?
Spot on. Hi, Andrea. Hi, all. Let me first say that what Anne and Melanie just said really resonate with me. In saying that, I mean, I really acknowledge the importance of taking care of social and economic sustainability. As I acknowledge, sustainability is a very broader term. It's not just carbon emission, right? But as I'm an engineer, and as I work for a company that provides solution for the monitoring of energy-related emissions, I just wanted to bring you down the path of a more pragmatic and concrete analysis, right? Which is actually looking at the end-to-end process of AI. So from the chips manufacturing to the data center operation and where all these prime materials and energy comes from, right? And I think that the key word here is transparency. I think that what we are lacking right now, and not just in AI, in a lot of other sectors, is end-to-end transparency in all processes. we can definitely improve there. And I've been reading an article seven days ago from Bloomberg where Dr. Sasha Luzzoni was actually making an example citing the most famous AI product right now, ChatGPT, and it made me really crack because, and now I'm quoting, she said, "We are talking about ChatGPT and we know nothing about it." She said, "It could be three raccoons in a trench coat." And really, this is an extreme quote, of course, but you know, this is what we're talking about. In terms of energy consumption, what emissions are related with the electricity that these data centers, where the AI is running, we know very little. And we will enter maybe in with more detail in down the conversation.
Thank you very much. So now I'd like to hand over to the standardization points of view. And you, Melanie, you mentioned it already. So what is really the surrounding, when is AI sustainable from the standardization point of view? I would like to start with you, Valerie, and then Ali, you on stage have the word. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you for letting me speak in this interesting gathering. This event is quite exciting to attend. And to add to what previous speakers were talking about sustainability, I would like to mention that sustainability doesn't mean conservation of resources, because we are expecting that our society will continue growing. And for me, sustainable growth means that we have to meet all the technological demands without undermining ecology and available resources and planetary resources. So I think that, as you mentioned, there are two aspects of this. One is use of resources for AI, for development and maintaining AI. And another is AI contribution to optimization of use of resources. At the moment, I'm working with a group of experts on development of a technical report in Standardization Committee, CEN-GTC 21. We are trying to formulate these requirements for the sustainable development of AI, these two sides, two major sides, facets of AI development. And we face one of the challenges as to how to define life cycle of AI. Because one thing that is immediately visible is when AI is applied, obviously. Another is what resources are used to maintain AI, how to train it and how to develop hardware and software for these purposes. But behind every piece of hardware, obviously, there is a delivery of materials, mining, transportation, and compilation of devices. So it is very, very complex process. And as Lord Kelvin, who is one of the founders of our organization in the beginning of 20th century, said once, if you want to know something, you need to measure it. In many aspects, there are gaps in measurement or estimation of requirements of AI. For instance, if you developed AI model and deployed it, you may estimate how much resources you already taken. But if somebody is retraining your AI model or changing some layers in the AI, and they need to not just deploy the ready model, but to modify it and retrain, it's again, resources are taken to run some digital infrastructure system. So to address all the aspects of running and applying and decommissioning AI, it's necessary to develop some structured algorithms and frameworks. That's what we are trying to address in currently developing standards and technical reports. So yes, it's work in progress, and we follow current literature. And I would like to say that our purpose is not to restrict AI. Our purpose is to make AI long-term sustainable and adequate for the sustainable development of technology and the civilization in general. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Ali, you have the word.
Thank you. I think Valerie started from looking at AI and sustainability from a systemic perspective, and that's where we would come from as well. There are a couple of initiatives regarding standardization that's been initiated at the Institute of Electrical Electronics Engineers, IEEE, over the past 7 years. I will quickly relate to those, but before I do, this issue of resource-consuming agents and the demand on the ecosystem that feeds them is the fundamental aspect. And what also happening within the context of European Union is the new consumer agenda vision that demands increasing transparency on environmental impact and digital claims by suppliers. So these are the settings within which standardization and sustainability need to be assessed and evaluated. Now, as far as a general framework goes, frankly, the old-fashioned approach of just identifying risks and minimizing the downside of any technology needs to be balanced with a probably new perspectives, because we are in a new paradigm with AI, and it's no longer the same as sustainability matters that we were dealing with on socioeconomic and ecological and even technological facets. The way we saw it was basically AI to be useful and sustainable, it needs to be purposeful, it needs to be inclusive, so its purpose as well as its value needs to be consulted extensively, not just decided by developers. It needs to be responsible. And the dimension that I think we need to add to the philosophical approach to AI sustainability is its regenerative nature. We cannot just minimize use and resource consumption. We need to try and encourage regeneration by all the energy-consuming agents as well. And IEEE started initiative that gone into two directions. One is development of series of AI-related, largely ethics standards, under the banner of 7000 series. So there is an IEEE 7000 that's made available to all the global community, and that addresses ethical issues in the design of what we call autonomous intelligence systems, which is our version of reference to AI. And the second thing, focus on the responsible dimension. We have an entire certification program developed around transparency, accountability, freedom from algorithmic bias, fairness, as well as respect for privacy and responsible governance. These come with extensive set of predictors and metrics, something of the order of a couple of hundred in each category, and this is the foundation of IEEE's approach under the banner of certified program that actually measures the responsible dimension of AI sustainability with a view to also independently verify and certify global products and separate the claim in terms of transparency from a supplier to an independent verifiable basis.
Very interesting points from all of you, I think. It's very difficult to pick the next question because we have so many points that we can touch on right now. I would like to stay on the topic of standardization for now. So, Valerie, you mentioned it, AI and the life cycle of it. So, for life cycle analysis, we need system boundaries. And which should be the system boundaries that we should look at and analyze, and from there on make a clear sorting what AI is, when is AI sustainable or not. So how can standardization help here, and what is the current status? So let's have a closer look on the current status of the standardization today. I think this is also very important to make more clear to the audience. Valerie, please go ahead on this topic.
I would like to say that when we assess consumption of resources at various stages of AI development and deployment, obviously it's very easy to be drawn in so many details and so many sub-processes, and it may become an infinite exercise somehow. So it is extremely important to focus on those that contribute the most or heaviest in terms of consumption of resources. Because obviously we can focus on, for instance, on manufacturing semiconductor hardware devices that are required for AI. But it's known that their costs are gradually decreasing. And in principle, how much energy is per such unit is required is becoming smaller and smaller. If in particular country running a data center on some fossil fuels is major contribution, then we have to focus on that. Even in other country, because we have to be aware that even across European subcontinent, there is a very large diversity in what fuels are used for electricity generation. If you look at France, the majority of it will be, almost 70% will be nuclear energy. If you look at Poland, majority of it may be brown coal. And the same electricity unit used for AI in that place or that place will be completely different in terms of indirect carbon emissions. And on the background of that major contribution, something very well calculated but minor, like a piece of semiconductor device, may be negligible in terms of impact of AI use. So I think it is extremely important to structure this analysis in first identifying the scale of contribution, and then quantifying in more detail particular major contributor in AI impact. It may be water in other countries where electricity may be absolutely green. The fresh water that is required for running data centers, et cetera, may be a principal major factor that should be analyzed in terms of environmental sustainability. On the other hand, of course, AI will and already does help in optimization of resources that required for any consumption of resources, in particular for running digital infrastructure. So I think we have to be first of all, smart in identifying these contributing factors. And second, we have to be well equipped with sufficient input materials and estimates that would help us to quantify it correctly, because uncertainties are large at every stage of analysis, as I faced it as a data scientist in particular applications. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like to give this question also to Anne. So how could standardization help to make the life cycle not as diffuse as we have and complex as we have it right now, but on the point?
Well, I couldn't agree more with what Valerie said, because I think it's important to really, in standardization efforts, also to integrate a perspective on the whole AI life cycle. And that means starting with the minerals that are needed for building the hardware that is needed. Because what we see is also when we talk about assessments of what AI can do for sustainability, we always see a very limited focus of the environmental costs of AI systems. And that leads to overly optimistic assumptions about what AI can do for sustainability. If we really take into account the entire AI life cycle, these judgments would sometimes be very different. And I think it's very, very important to see and to ask the question, when do we really want to apply an AI solution? When is it really necessary? And when is it really beneficial for sustainability questions? Also, I agree, and there I want to make the point or pick up the point that Giacomo made earlier, that we need transparency along the entire AI lifecycle, because like Valerie said, it depends on context. We see in North America and also South America that especially big tech companies, they like to put their data centers in very sunny and dry regions because they want to use the solar energy. But that can aggravate water crisis. In Chile, for example, we see the situation where Chile is struck by an ongoing drought for years now, and they have data centers by big tech there that consume immense amounts of water. So we really have to come to very detailed and often case-based analysis of what sustainable AI means, and there we need a lot more transparency. And at the same time, I want to say transparency is only the initial step that we have to take, because currently in the AI Act that is negotiated in the European Union, we see that the lack of transparency leads to a lack of good regulation or even the ability to regulate artificial intelligence from a sustainability perspective. So transparency is the first step, but then we need that transparency as a basis for good regulation.
Perfect. Thank you. And I would like to hand over to Ali with the same question. How can standardization help with the life cycle analysis?
Well, we can take two perspectives on this. One is the traditional classical view of AI life cycle. And as Valerie has gone through, basically developing a perspective on consumption and energy as well as resources at every phase of this life cycle. Our focus in the standardization work is largely been on the responsible dimension, which again is hugely contextual. Life cycle is something generic and universal, whereas the context of application to us matters in the societal and sometimes even ecological and economic dimension. And the particular perspectives that I have highlighted, frankly, from the societal acceptance and refer to necessity for transparency. Frankly, transparency is the hygiene factor behind ethics of anything. If you are not transparent, you cannot claim acceptability from a societal perspective because you can't explain and there is obfuscation and lack of clarity of intent and means and purpose, etc. So where we put most of our energy in the standardization and the particular certification regime that I referred to was on the contextually sensitive, responsible aspect of it. And much of the responsible aspect focus was on the societal impact and sociological dimension rather than ecological or economic facets of this. And we have this 5 or 6 categories of independent scrutiny of a particular context of application of AI that does not immediately look at energy considerations, frankly, but it looks at societal impact as the particular facets that I have highlighted: accountability, freedom from bias, transparency, which, as I said, is a hygiene factor for any ethical context. Then there are matters of respect for privacy, see beyond the traditional GDPR and legal protection. And finally, whether there is any element of fairness about the application. And there are aspects that may shortchange particular groups. And the final overarching approach for us is also responsible governance. Is there an embedded structure, policies and procedures that actually governs from all of the key players and supply chain the development of AI? So that's the particular responsible dimension amongst the purposeful, inclusive, responsible and regenerative focus that are highlighted, been tackled by IEEE in its initiatives on responsible AI.
Thank you very much, Ali. Now I'd like to hand the microphone, so to say, to the two companies here, Deutsche Telekom and Flexidao. How do you contribute to the points that were mentioned just now from all of the, from Valerie, from Anne, and from Ali? So how do you measure it? How do you approach the whole topic? What is your contribution to making AI sustainable? Maybe Giacomo, I would like to start with you.
Thank you, Andrea. To explain that, I will first say that, you know, AI, as we mentioned before, is running on data centers, right? And data centers are energy intensive facilities. So what we do is to help data centers provider to have more visibility on the shade of green of the electricity they consume. In saying that, I mean, we help them monitor every hour of the day or with sub-hourly resolution when required. What the carbon intensity of the electricity that they procure, that they buy, and then consume. And this help them to actually plan ahead the next steps to fill the carbon intensive gaps in their day, throughout the day. And these help them also to elevate their brands to a sustainable leadership position. So this is basically what we do. And we don't do it just with data centers. We do it also for another sector that is picking up this transparent energy transparency idea, which is actually the telecom industry. Actually, we have been working with, we work with Google for the data centers, mapping the data centers in several countries in Europe, work with Microsoft, helping them to track their data center in the whole Dutch territory. But linking back to the telecoms, we also work with Vodafone in Spain, tracking their antennas all over the countries. And also with antennas providers like CENELEC in Spain. So basically, we help them to do the same, to track track and certify that they consume every hour of the day clean electricity.
Transparency. That was definitely your code word.
Transparency is the key. Transparency and actionability. We provide an actionable framework to go clean, consume clean electricity every hour of the day. With a clear framework and tooling that help to execute on this framework.
So you're situated in the part where AI is already developed and in use, and you're helping them now to really look on, okay, so what is the carbon footprint? And also during the development, the energy consumption and...
Exactly. That's very important. We can also help all the value chain track their energy, which is extremely important because we actually work with a couple of companies that then they said, okay, so we are doing for our under indirect emission called scope 2 emission, but what about our supply chain? So they advocated our solution to their supply chain, and now the whole or the majority of their supply chain is tracking with hourly granularity and with stricter geographical boundaries to make sure that the actual flow of electricity is flowing to their facility.
Okay, Anne, you raised your hand, and then I would like to give Melanie the word to say what Deutsche Telekom and how you're contributing.
Sorry, I didn't want to jump in. I could also speak later, but I just wanted to point out that this sort of transparency, of course, is great. But like you said, Andrea, that we also need to consider what runs on these data centers. So if we talk about sustainable AI, we really need to talk about an organizational mind shift so that from the start, from the first conception and planning, we have sustainability as the goal, because it is in every micro decision along the entire life cycle of AI systems, it needs to be implemented. Of course, using renewable energies and accounting for the energy and emissions that are produced by AI system is great, but this is not sustainable AI. We need to really look at the entire decision-making process along the entire AI life cycle. Sorry.
Okay, perfect. Thank you for that. Now, Melanie, I think you have a very broad approach to AI.
I think we do also, because we're in most of the cases not really developing, we're purchasing it and using it for our own purposes, or we're using it for purposes which are customer related, specifically B2B related. So we're really one of these consumers, that then build products together in order to make it work for us and for our customers. And I think for us, you mentioned, and Anna very rightfully said, having green energy in the data center is a good start, but it's not everything. Though I have to say, because we're running big data centers for a number of customers worldwide, for us it's a very important start, because that's the first part where you start decoupling the emissions from the energy demand itself. Still knowing that you have to go on looking at how to reduce the energy demand consistently for AI and also for all other software products. I think this is a whole industry topic which goes beyond AI, though AI is will be the big application in the future that will drive the energy hunger of the data centers. But this is where it starts. This is where we feel we're quite good equipped in measuring how much we consume, also going down to the level of the servers and the infrastructure to understand which component consumes what. But then if you go deeper into that, going to the chipsets, going to the processors, et cetera, this is where I think the complication starts, while also monitoring is still a bit difficult to be implemented, though we know we need to get there. And the second thing is, as I said, while designing it the right way, and this is where we're all still on the development path, it also goes into the supply chain. It goes a lot into how do we work with all these suppliers around us who provide us with the components, also with the AI itself. To what extent can we get more detailed into understanding how they approach this and what we can do in order to bring their emissions down, if we talk about the environmental side, which is really important for us. And also there, we're also waiting and we're watching and observing what happens in terms of the standardization, which has been mentioned by many of you today here. What can we learn from that and how can we implement that in our management and monitoring system? Because we have a very strong belief, if you don't measure, you can't manage it. Yeah, that's very, very simple. And this is so true for E, for S, for G, whatever dimension you talk about, you need to get the transparency, the data, and you need to put it into the context and then make decisions based on the outcome. Yeah, it's not a reporting thing. It's really a management question, which is on the table. Where we are a bit further ahead is really, I think, the social side that has also been mentioned by Ali, also on data protection, on the question what type of data we use. We do have an established committee at Deutsche Telekom that looks very carefully into what are the social principles, what type of biases are used. Not that we have all the answers, by far not, but there is a high level of awareness. And I think for us, what is important that on that body, which is a lot driven by our colleagues who drive generally the ethical standards of the company, There is technology for sure. They are one of the biggest stakeholders on that topic, but it also contains, there are also people, for example, from HR, because it is a cultural question. At what point you implement that type of principles and also processes to audit products that we want to use, yeah, and whether they fulfill and live up to all the principles that we have designed, and how we then can also be transparent, monitor and certify that so that we can also give proof to our customers who are asking us on these topics. So this is a little bit the layer that I look onto, and as said, we feel quite good equipped for now, yeah, knowing that the now always changes. Next month, we will have new things on the table. For now, in terms of measuring the data center part and going deeper into that one, but when it comes to going into the individual processes and consumption of singular software products and how to tackle that and how to tackle specifically AI in terms of the ecological questions, and this is also where we, which is on the table right now. Since a few months, this is also an area where we look deeper into and try to find out how can we get a grip on that? How can we get an LCA? Do we need an LCA, or are there other elements which we should concentrate on? So that's exactly where we are at the moment with the questions around standardization. How do we apply this as a company?
Perfect. Thank you very much for this view on from Deutsche Telekom and from Flexidao from the company side. And I think we already touched so many points on that next question that I would have liked to ask is about where do we need to go? Like, do we need to go down into the chip production, or where is really the focus point where we need to? That we need to set right now. And I think you all agreed on, okay, chips production, we really need to go down the whole supply chain, not only on the operational side and from various perspectives, social and economical and ecological. That is very, very good to hear, which is why I would like to turn the view a little bit on what was mentioned in the beginning. I think it was you, Melanie, as well, who mentioned it first, saying we need to have a look on the applications, maybe. So will we have a prioritization here? So let's take an example. It is broadly discussed in the energy sector where I'm currently working. So will we see AI in the energy sector, maybe in the weather forecasting and communication between the renewables and the consumers, or in the modeling, is that going to be a big lever for CO2 reduction? Question mark. So will we have application focuses for AI in the future? Valerie, please, you raised your hand.
I have to say that such application already exists and broadly used in industry. In the UK, there are so-called demand-side response programs where AI can be deployed to forecast consumption, reduce consumption, optimize consumption. It is already a work in progress rather than a future plan. And I have to say that another major aspect is behavioral, because obviously AI by itself is a piece of technology. It's how people use it, how people deploy it, because of course AI can be used in a very smart way to reduce the use of resources, but AI can also be used for kind of consumerism expansion with multiple videos and other AI technologies applied, like ChatGPT, for purpose only for exploration or playful kind of application. I think many people are already conscious about the impact of IT on environment. And for instance, in our organization, there is a so-called green team where people gather together to offer specific solutions on how to reduce energy consumption across the laboratory. And people are, I can see that people who are far away from AI development or application, they try to contribute to this social movement, I would say, at the level of organization. I know that many people try to reduce their carbon footprint, and that is commendable. But at the same time, you can see on social media infinite kittens and videos modified with AI, because you can play with AI on your smartphone. And upload of such videos is viral. You can imagine the carbon footprint of that when I see that online. It's quite amusing. But I think that there is this parallel development of people who are specialists in AI, who are trying to put AI at service for sustainable development. At the same time, at the general public, people who become conscious about their contribution, and they try to reduce unnecessary, I would say, use or overuse of technologies, and help our efforts, scientific efforts, to optimize our energy consumption. Thank you.
So it's a matter of sensibilization of the society that you're addressing here. So making people aware of their energy and energy use and their carbon footprint consumption.
Yeah, because the new AI solutions are exciting. I can fully understand that. And yeah, people want to try it and play with it. It is a wonderful toy. And I'm pretty sure it will serve many useful purposes. Ensure that it's good to make public aware that it should be reasonable, I would say.
Yeah. Melanie, you raised your hand. Please go ahead.
Yeah, I think, what Valerie said is completely right. And we see this with ChatGPT and comparable applications. Also here at Deutsche Telekom, everyone is super excited to try it out. And the first thing that happened is that everyone looked at what does it mean in terms of the IPRs, what does it mean in terms of the social consequences of using it. And we sort of got our head around whether we want to allow using it or not. But what was not looked at in the first place is this ecological thing. Yeah, should we always do what we're allowed to do or what we could do, because simply technology offers that? Yeah, this is what I mentioned with this principle of overconsumption, that or excessive consumption, that unfortunately is one of the big issues generally in digitization. That to, if it's very convenient and playful and nice for everyone to use things, it is often not looked at whether we should really go down this way. And I think this is where transparency and talking to consumers really helps. But I also believe it requires more discussions on the regulative side, on the regulatory bodies, not in order to forbid things, because I don't believe in that principle that you should principally forbid things. This would just create more hunger to still try it out, yeah, and find out how it works. It's probably more on giving very clear frames, yeah, and design principles to the ones who develop that type of applications, so that you can make better decisions between cases where AI really helps you to drive sustainability in areas where without AI it's probably not possible to really manage your resource footprint. Yeah, for Deutsche Telekom, for example, a big application case definitely is the network management. Yeah, where when we operate fixed line networks like we do in Germany and some other European markets, we're typically one of the top 3, 4, 5 energy consumers of the country. Yeah, no one sees that because our lines are in the ground or on towers that you don't see. Yeah, we don't have big steel production, but still, electricity wise, it's a huge consumer. Yeah, so a very clever energy management system that helps us to decide automatically when to switch on, when to put more power on sites, when to do less, that can be very successful. And we're piloting, trying this out. This is the area where also we have a lot of own developments. This works quite well. But the ChatGPT side, for me, is honestly a bit worrying. And I think this is where we need to, where also we need regulative support to put the right design principles down.
OK, Okay, perfect. Thank you. So we're already running out of time. This is why I would like to give the word also to Ali on this topic. So will we see prioritization of AI applications? What is your point of view on this?
Apart from the area of consumer agenda that I referred to with targets for 2025, the European AI Act also looks at high-risk applications of AI. And frankly, looking at the high carbon footprint to start with, my honest view is that in the absence of regulation catching up with the advancing technology, the standardization probably offers an interim solution. And to that extent, frankly, again, from social impact and societal perspective, we have concentrated on governance aspects of AI in terms of a full life cycle perspective, and recently published what we call an ontological specifications on responsible governance of autonomous and intelligent systems that's been distributed under the Creative Commons license for free. People can download this, and this is a set of high-level predictors for responsible governance. And this particular prioritization is a relevant issue here because, frankly, before regulation determines high risk and ecological impact and high carbon footprint should be regarded as those high risk components, eventually, we are dependent ultimately on the responsible governance by the marketplace, by the developers, by the supply chain. And our contribution to this discussion has largely been, instead of actually waiting for the regulation to say what's permitted and what needs to be prioritized, let's go back towards some form of corporate social responsibility, the old-fashioned label, and go for responsible governance and its independent verification and certification so that the companies exercise this. Should we indulge in producing AI for this particular application or for that context, and in a sense, self-regulate? That's what we believe standards are likely to fill the gap until the regulations catch up.
Thank you very much. Since we started a little bit later, I would also like to give the word back to Anne and Giacomo on this very topic. So application prioritization, will we see it and in what context? Anne, you raised your hand earlier.
Yes, on a different point, because I just wanted to also highlight that I agree with Melanie on the regulation part, because I think there's a limit to this responsibility that we can give to the average user and the end consumer, so to say. I want to just shed light on the fact that, you know, we see a lot of unsustainable tendencies, especially right now. I see some very worrying developments with OpenAI and ChatGPT or GPT-4. And the tendency to really close down these systems and be very intransparent about it. We don't know anything about it. We don't know anything about data sets. We don't know anything about the resources it consumed. And now we have statements on the table that they really don't think that open source is the right way and that their decisions in the past were wrong. So this is something I've read today in an interview in The Verge. So this is extremely worrying, and I think we need regulation that makes sure that AI systems become developed in more sustainable ways, because it can't be either or, you know, it can't be unsustainable or completely sustainable. And then we need the right kind of railroads to lead big AI developers to more sustainable approaches. At least in the European Union, we might see tendencies in that way. But I'm also a little bit pessimistic about the sustainability aspect in the AI Act, even though we see some movement in the Parliament right now. But is it is kind of the sectoral high-risk approach that is taken in the AI Act doesn't really fit with a sustainability approach. So there's this kind of discrepancy from the start. So this is my point on that.
Quite worrying words. I hope we don't end with those, although it can also be because the pressure is on, the pressure is on many, many sectors, and we need to monitor our emissions, our energy consumption. But Giacomo, please add on, do you think we need to prioritize the AI application?
Yeah, I will be very, very brief. Although I really believe in the power of regulation and standardization, in fact, we, as Flexidao, we have been participating and being very vocal in the revision of the greenhouse gas protocol that it's now on. I also believe in the power of educating users and the public. So that's why at Flexidao we have launched the 24/7 Carbon Free Energy Academy online, which is a free tool where everybody can sign up and learn how we can move forward and be more, again, transparent about the carbon intensity of the energy that data centers or other businesses are using. So the first module is very high level. It's about the high level dialogue on energy. So it's very clear also for non-experts. So I invite you all to sign up and to get educated on this important matter.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So, yeah, I'm afraid we're already out of time, but thank you very much. It was very interesting, at least for me, to discuss with you this very interesting topic. And I think there will be more discussions around this topic, and you all are working on this topic. So let's maybe come back in this round some other time again and see where we developed from here. And thank you very much for listening from the audience and being with us. And thank you to the panelists for your time, for your views and your points on this very important topic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Folks, with our apologies for overrunning this session, if there are any questions, do feel free to forward it to any one of us. I'm here. I'm happy to take the questions and share with my fellow panelists to respond to whatever urgent matter that you felt we didn't have time to discuss. Thank you very much for your attention. We are being urged to close the session because we are severely overrun. Thank you, folks.
Yeah, thanks everybody for participating. We're now taking a lunch break here at the Exhibition Forum, and we continue our session at 1:30.